Hello and welcome. I was having a little bit of complication at first. Okay, today we're talking about loneliness again, and loneliness is really reaching epidemic proportions in our nation. And in fact, one out of every three adults admits to being lonely. So loneliness is a reality, and it's something that I think all of us face at some time in our life. Loneliness comes in many forms. It can come with the loss of the best friend, your life partner, a parent, a child, your sibling. It can be the loss of a pet or your home or a career. Many different forms. And there's a loss and there's a grieving. There's a sense of emptiness as you lose something you treasured. There may even be grieving over something beautiful that could have been that is not going to happen. And that's really hard when you face that. Loneliness is real. And loneliness is something that's like a fingerprint. For each person, it's unique. You may go through the loss of a pet, and I go through the loss of a pet, but we both experience it in a different way because you are unique and your circumstances are uniquely your own. And so your pain is important because you are important. And we don't have to compare ourselves and say, this is the way I do it, so you have to do it this way. But we are to give each other grace, love, and learn to walk with each other. And so you may feel overwhelmed. You may feel difficult, really struggle to get out of bed in the morning. For each of us, it's different. For some of us, for myself, I just kind of went tight, compacted myself, and withdrew. So we all are very different. And when we talk about loneliness, there's no one pattern. There's no one set of symptoms that is unique for everyone. You may feel despair. I may feel depression. It doesn't mean there's something wrong with you, that you're lacking. But when I talk, I'm going to talk in general terms. And because I don't know your specific story, I can't touch everything that you're experiencing. So let's just look at the surface, the general principles, the big picture, and try to draw hope from that, because there is good news. Loneliness is not got the final word. Loneliness is something we can bring a boundary around and learn to handle. It's difficult. I assure you it's difficult, but we can learn to set boundaries for loneliness. So loneliness does not rule us. Hello, I'm Barbara Hitching, and this is Transformative Tuesday. And whether you're alive or watching later, I'm so glad you have joined me. And I hope you'll write down below, maybe, where are you from? Are you on a different time zone? Is it nighttime there? Where are you from? And the question I'm going to begin with is, have you ever struggled with loneliness? I'm sure you have. So were you a child or were you an adult? Can you write that down below? And again, one out of every three adults experiences loneliness. And I believe this is not just relevant for America, but for the whole world. We're all walking through our own unique set of circumstances, and loneliness is part of life. Yes, that is great, Galena. We can learn to set boundaries for loneliness. So loneliness does not rule over us, but we learn to rule over loneliness. Isn't that exciting? Well, When I was a young woman, I really severely struggled with loneliness. I had just gone through the loss of two very close family members, and then I was very active socially, engaged with so many different platforms of society. And I went to the MV Logos, the mission ship, and I was there while the ship was being outfitted and prepared for its maiden voyage. And I so loved the ship. I really, really loved my time on board. But I worked in my office. Take that back. My little cabin was my office. And so I lived in that tight little cabin at least 20 hours of the day. I was there. I was socially isolated. I didn't work with other people. I was a secretary and I was working in that little room, often 12 hours a day. And so I was so socially isolated that I began to spiral downwards. And that's the thing with loneliness. It grows. It doesn't just naturally go away, but it will grow unless there's boundaries. And feeling so alienated and empty inside, I didn't have anything to deal with it. I didn't know how to deal with it. And so when I was out of my cabin for meals and with other people, I didn't know how to interact with them because I had been so isolated for so many hours. And so I believed no one cared. I felt invisible. And again, I went small to self-protect. I withdrew. And feeling insignificant and unloved, I withdrew even more. But at the same time, I was trying so hard to be good enough. If I could just be enough, then people would like me. If I could just do the right thing, then people would want to be with me. People would understand me and care about me. But the harder I tried, the emptier I felt inside. And so those feelings of unworthiness grew and became overwhelming. And I felt trapped in loneliness, and I couldn't find any way of escape. The only way I could think of was suicide. I have another question for you. Did you know Marilyn Monroe, as beautiful as she was, as well loved as she was, believed she was unlovable? Have you ever felt unlovable? That you were not worthy of being loved? I have. And it's not a good feeling. And again, it isolates and it increases loneliness exponentially. So if you've just lost your mate, you may not have that same degree of loneliness because you've experienced the love of someone very precious to you, and now you've lost them. So you're going through grieving, and you are going to have to find a new normal. But with loneliness, the thing we need to remember is your thoughts matter. What you think will determine the path you take. So if you don't grieve your loss, if you don't name your loss, and if you don't experience and allow yourself to feel your pain, then what is going to happen is you're going to become constricted, and you're going to feel loneliness growing and taking over the horizons of your mind. And loneliness attacks the thought life. That's where it comes. Not just the heart, that's grief, that's pain. But those feelings of loneliness begin to churn in our mind, and they become open doors for the enemy to tell us we have no value, that we're not good enough, that people don't love us, that people don't care, that nobody can understand. And so those thoughts begin to take control of us. So the feeling of loneliness begins to grow and to rule over us. And it begins to consume us, not just our thought life, but it begins to shape who we are. So if you're listening to those kind of feelings, it's going to shape your identity. And you won't remember that you're loved of God. You won't remember that you're seated with Christ in heavenly places. Your world, your horizons will be, I'm lonely. I'm no good. And you'll be filling the blanks with negative thoughts. And those negative thoughts are toxic. And they're going to bring you down and take you captive to the lies of the enemy. Did you know the Lord Jesus has called you to himself? And right now, in the midst of whatever you're going through, he's calling you. He's calling you by name. He knows your name, and he knows the loneliness you're going through. He's already walked that path before you and conquered it. And so when we think about loneliness, it's not static. It's an enemy. It's an enemy to take control of our mind, to become a mindset and a state of being, and ultimately our identity. So loneliness is not a good place to stay. It's not a good place to rest. It is not your friend. But there's a way of escape. Yes, he knows your name. Isn't that beautiful? There is a way of escape. It took me a long, long time to learn this, but the Lord showed me Jeremiah 31:3, and the Lord said, oh yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Before time began, I loved you, and I have drawn you with loving kindness to myself. The Lord knows you. He knows your name. Before time began, he knew the failures, the mistakes, the sins you would make. He knew the losses you would experience, the heartbreak. And he cares. He cared then, and he cares now. And he sent the Lord Jesus to be your Savior and to draw you to himself. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Yes. Isn't that beautiful? And so that is a way of escape. And when I first read that, I was so puzzled. I didn't think God loved me, but it said the Lord. And so I thought, oh, the Lord Jesus. I can believe the Lord Jesus loves me and that he drew me to himself. And I began to speak those words over myself. I began to let that become a boundary. I wasn't unloved. I wasn't alone. The Lord was with me, and he loved me. And I want to say to you today, the Lord is with you, and he loves you. There is a way of escape. The Lord might not give you that verse. Ask him for a verse. But there will be words of love that he will speak straight to your heart that will minister life. So another question, we're in really troublous times right now. If you're experiencing social distancing with the coronavirus, what are you doing to help yourself stay connected with others? That's really important. You can write the answer below. But we need to think about this and not allow ourselves to become socially isolated. That's what happened to me. And that's when I was just thrown into loneliness because of all these other things that were happening, and I didn't know how to deal with it. So one of the first things we can think about as a call for action is to make sure we are not socially isolating ourselves from everyone. Stay connected to at least one person. Be in touch. Pick up the phone and talk to them. Don't just text, but talk. We need to hear the other person's voice. It's really good when we can see their face, too. There's something about the eyes, and studies have been done that if you make eye contact with another person and they make eye contact with you, it helps you feel less lonely. Isn't that amazing? God has made you in such an incredibly wonderful way, and He's given you so many things to help you move through these minefields of loneliness and fear, doubt, discouragement, social isolation. So the next call to action, ask Jesus to be the doorkeeper of your mind. Thoughts bombard us and they enter. We need a door that can be shut, that we shut the door, just like we shut the door of our house so wild animals don't come in, so robbers or crooks or whatever don't come in. We need a door for our mind. Jesus says, I am the door. Let Him be the doorkeeper and let Him answer the door of your mind, so that anything that comes to your heart goes through Him. Really important. That took me a long time to learn that. But when I started practicing that, my life began to just totally change so that I didn't walk in fear. The next thing is turn your thoughts on Jesus. Do you remember this story of Jesus quieting the raging storm, calming the wind and the sea? He is whispering to you. He wants to quiet the storms of your mind and quiet your heart with His love. But it's a choice. You have to let Him. To be honest, it feels good when you think about feeling lonely. I don't know why, but we feel good when we just meditate on being lonely. And so we're getting something out of it. What are you getting out of it? For me, I got a sense of being valuable. I didn't feel valuable to anyone else, but I felt valuable to me. That was a lie. And so whatever we're clinging to will become an idol in our life. So invite Jesus to quiet the storm of loneliness. And it is a storm, and the waves and the wind will knock you to the ground unless you invite the Lord to quiet the raging sea within you. You are an incredible person. You have a beautiful brain. You have a mind that is incredible, but it can get sidetracked by thoughts from the enemy. You have an incredible promise in scriptures. When you come to know Jesus as your Savior, He gives you His own mind. You have the mind of Christ. That means in Christ, you are more than a conqueror. You can conquer loneliness through the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. You can use the name of Jesus to fight when the assault is at its worst. And you can learn to open your mouth and sing. Give thanks and sing praises to our Lord, because He has ordained for you to be hidden in Him. Hidden with Christ in God, seated in heavenly places. Your identity is not lonely. or loneliness, or worthlessness, or unloved. Your identity is beloved. You are the beloved of God. And so I encourage you this week to meditate on the Word, to invite Jesus to be the door of your heart and of your mind. Let Him be Lord, and let Him calm the raging storms in your life. So I'm Barbara Hitching, and I hope you will join me at barbarahitching.com. I'm going to have a post there. And if you need to talk to someone and you don't have anyone, message me, private message me, and we can talk. So know you are loved. You are very special. You are unique. And God loves you very much, and He has chosen for you to be in community with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to never be alone. God bless you. Take care. I love you. Bye-bye.